Well, I hope you guys are ready for our last game of the night. It is very, very late right now. We had a very, very late start in general. I can't say how many times we started a cast at midnight. But this last game of the night, Revenge versus eHug, game two. We have to see whether or not Revenge can take one game of the evening or if they're going to go home with four different losses, putting them pretty much in the worst position of the MLG TKO with no way out. Like, eHug was supposed to be their big hope because the other three, right? Cloud9, Team Liquid, Evil Geniuses, I don't think you're knocking one of those down a peg. Like, no, don't get me wrong. Team Revenge, they have had some beautiful upsets in the past, but it's not something you rely on. They were supposed to be the ones fighting up against Team eHug to see who gets knocked out, and already it's looking very, very grim with two losses earlier to Evil Geniuses and now one loss to Team eHug. So it's pretty much do or die for them as we get into the draft, guys, and I can welcome in my co-caster Hippie. He's going to be joining me once again on the microphone.
All I have to say is if you don't like casting Dota in the middle of the night, shouldn't have moved away from America.
Yeah.
Us real casters are still here. I'm excited that we finally get an Invoker and an Ember Spirit, though. Heroes that have been either banned or skipped every single series after now. Banned out for the entire EG series, and I think just completely ignored in the last game between these two. Very popular heroes. It was kind of weird to not see either of them.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I can't believe we haven't seen an Ember Spirit all night. Same goes with the Invoker, though it's still not on the team I want to see it on. I want to see a Smash Invoker, but maybe we'll see a Smash Ember Spirit. Team eHug, though, they pick up the Invoker as the Nyx Assassin, so I like that, though. I really like that combo because Nyx Assassin, not only is he strong versus Ember Spirit anyway, good disables, mana burn, very strong versus an Ember Spirit who relies so heavily upon the small amount of mana that he does have. Don't get me wrong. He's got a pretty decent-sized mana pool, but compared to the spam of all of his abilities and how costly some of them are, it's you rely on every little bit of mana that you have. So one mana burn can really mess you up in a team fight. It's why you see many Ember Spirits going for mana boots. Like, that is, like, how many carries can you really identify that end up going for mana boots? You know, it just goes to show how dependent that hero is upon his limited mana pool.
Yeah, I definitely agree with you there. And I like not having the Nyx against your Invoker, because it's so frustrating for a late game Invoker who stacked up so much intelligence to deal with that mana burn. But also, if it turns out to be an Exort Invoker, if he wants to go a very kind of bursty sort of thing, that Nyx suddenly becomes anyone who gets caught alone by that Nyx once he's level 6 is just dead to a Sunstrike. There's no way to screw that up. Unless, I mean, maybe the Ember Spirit, depending on whether or not he can time the invulnerability very well to dodge it. But in general, if the Nyx gets a Vendetta hit and then a stun, they're already dead. I mean, it's some Fist of the North Star stuff right there.
Yeah, I really, really agree. I love seeing the Exort Invoker with any sort of Bounty Hunter, Nyx Assassin, like any one of those heroes, just because you basically it provides the tipping point where Nyx Assassin, a lot of times, like if he's offlane, if he's support, if he's one of those roles that he doesn't get the full amount of experience, oftentimes he picks up level 7, he moves around the map, and yeah, you see some heroes, but you by yourself can't really pick that up. But when you have an Exort Invoker, it's like, I can do that. Like every single, even some of the tougher carries that you come across, you go, no, actually, I can kill him with just me here, thanks to the global range of an Exort Invoker being able to throw down that Sunstrike and provide that extra huge amount of burst damage. We're going to see the Doom as well as the Disruptor being banned away by Revenge. Puck and Brewmaster banned out by Team eHug. Again, taking away some of those initiators that work well with Ember Spirit. However, this could still be an Ember Spirit mid if they want to run it that way. However, it means he's going to be having to deal with going up against an Invoker who's very, very strong against melees, being able to output a lot of harassment, especially with Cold Snap. But there are ways to mitigate that, and it doesn't even mean dual lanes. We could see something. I don't know if Revenge have ever tried this, but I have been a big fan of what Na'Vi recently running, which was the Dream Protector. When you have an Ember Spirit mid, allows that hero to just... He has so much survivability. It gives him that edge in the laning phase, as well as allows him to just go balls deep going into the mid game because he has that extra bit of survivability.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, his main problems, you mentioned his mana pool, and the other one is his fragility. He's fragile at all stages of the game, has terrible, terrible stat growth, so pretty much every single kind. So if you have a hero to already compensate for the fragility, you can focus on solving your mana pool issue through itemization. And then, of course, with both of those issues solved, he's an incredibly devastating hero. Now, I don't want to say immediately, I'm going to assume it's going to be an invoker, but did you see the Dream League game where Eternal Envy played a one-position Exord Voker?
I did. I did see that. I can't say I'm the biggest fan. Like, I saw potential in it already, because I think I have seen one position invokers. It wasn't that, like, heavily focused on the carry role. It was more of a sort of, we don't want to run invoker up against this, and we're running a really, really aggressive mid-game oriented strategy, so we don't actually need anything bigger than an invoker. But I can't say I'm the biggest fan of it.
All right, I thought it was an interesting divergence on the usual Exort Invoker stuff, where you're focusing on Sunstrike and Meatball to focus completely on Forge Spirit and Cold Snap. The early Medallion was something I just never would have even thought about, but it proved to be incredibly effective on that hero. But you know, obviously that's not going to be a strategy that a lot of people are going to like. Eternal Envy already is willing to play some kind of odd heroes a lot of the time, and Cloud9, they are a very experimental team. They're willing to take some pretty big risks in the draft. Paid off for them then. I'm not sure eHug is going to be willing to do the same thing. But I just wanted to put that out there, because it's something I think we will see at least one or two more teams try before the next couple of months are over.
Okay. I will keep an open mind to it. I just personally see, like, the potential of that hero kind of getting shut down and not being able to provide enough of, like, putting Invoker in that position and allowing him to be able to farm up all of that. I see just so many other heroes being able to utilize that same amount of farm and also be able to deal with the lack of experience that comes from having that kind of position. A lot better than an invoker if you want to roll the way he did. But this game, though, it doesn't look like we're going to see it. We're going to see a Morana and Shadow Shaman pick up from Team eHug. And I think this time it is going to be a Jigabilly Morana. Offlane Nyx Assassin and Ryu taking up the invoker in the mid lane. Crystal Maiden and Batrider going to be the pickups from Revenge. And real quick, I am going to hang up on you and recall you, because our Skype call just went south as hell. All right, we still got a little bit of static, but it sounds a little bit better, and I think it'll clear up.
All right. Man, it was the first. Maybe it's not just the other studio, man. This was the first time it happened with the main studio, yeah.
Yeah, I think it's just the connection between us. It's just you're on the other side
of the
world.
Damn you, Europe!
I know. I've tried. Believe me, I have tried to get joinDOTA to make a studio in America, but these Germans,
expansion.
Yeah, they know how to hold on to their money, and expanding into America. And not really your first option when it comes to it. Just would be just so expensive compared to many other places where you could expand to, you know.
Well, and just in general, opening multiple esports studios for the same brand, generally, if you're doing all of your work online, it's like, why are you doing this?
Yeah.
I can't really blame him for that one.
But Apple Pie and the Bald Eagle.
It's
and
true. I love America. Don't get me wrong.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, yes. Is it the support Wraith King? It's the support Wraith King that's been making the rounds. I can almost promise you this. I absolutely love that. Honestly, like, I was with Trixie. I remember Trixie saying something very early when this aura first got changed that support Wraith King is going to be a thing. And I saw that aura and I thought to myself, that is amazing. You don't even need him to carry. He's now one of those supports like Abaddon who you can't focus him because he just gets right back up. But at the same time, you can't deal with 30% free lifesteal on all their carries. Actually gets completely reduced. And that stun is really good.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's 8-second cooldown, 2-second stun, 2-second slow with good damage on it.
Yeah, I agree. Because I was always a big fan of Team Fire, right? When they first came onto the scene, I will always go back to this. When we talk about Wraith King, they came onto the scene with their carry Wraith King, which was a four staff. And while it was a carry, it was very, very aggressive, right? And I always loved seeing that kind of style of Wraith King. However, I don't think we're going to be seeing it this time. I think this is going to be support Mirana. And sure enough, Amish Sheep's going to be on that Mirana. Jugabilly will be handling the Wraith King. I just hope that we don't see the refresher Wraith King that we saw not too long ago.
You don't want him to be balling out of control?
No,
I mean, come on.
I really don't.
Come on.
I really don't, especially against a lot of these heroes, which are so good at kiting. Batrider and the two supports, super, super good at being able to kite around melee heroes.
Look, man, just get a refresher, get a Divine Rapier, balling out of control, no problem. No problem.
No.
Turn on your armlet. You're not too noob to activate it. You have one active ability, and I'm done. I had to go there.
Oh, that was a fun, interesting game. Anyway, guys, let's go ahead and talk about, real quick, who's playing what? Revenge! We got Mystico, who's laying down a very, very early ward. Rune Ward just to be able to see some vision, and it looks like he's actually going to be taking the offlane, and Mihawk is going to be straight up jungling from the very, very beginning, not even wanting to mess with the Shadow Shaman Mirana combo, and I can't say I blame him. So Mystico's going to be on an offlane Rubick, or at least for now. We'll see if he rotates at all. Smash is going to be playing the middle Centaur. We'll see how he does there. Mihawk playing the jungle Batrider. Benj is going to be on the safe lane carry Ember Spirit. And that leaves Masoku going to be playing the Crystal Maiden. On the other side, we got Pandago on the Shadow Shaman. Amasheep on the Mirana. Off lane is going to be Cakes on his Nyx Assassin. Middle is Ryu Burrows on the Invoker. And that leaves Jigabilly on the Wraith King. And let's hope he does better than last time.
This feels like a Smash hero to me. I mean, sure, it's not like a traditional mid hero, but it's tanky. It, you know, can get in there, make a lot of things happen. I'm sure he can do some good stuff with his Centaur if he doesn't get zoned out completely. I mean, I'm a sheep. One of the nice things about support Mirana is because you can really get so much done with just an arrow and a leap at early levels. She can spend a lot of time just pressuring other lanes, not worrying too much about experience. She can catch up a little bit later. She can, you know, have maybe help clear some stacks somewhere to get some bursts of experience. But, you know, she can just run around and zone people out and make them afraid. And now that she's rotating bottom, they're going to see that with the ward, just barely. But still, at the same time, Mystico, he's not going to be able to stick around here at all.
Yeah, but honestly, him picking up any experience is a surprise to me, because honestly, just Pandago by itself, this is such a dangerous lane in Mystico. I think he made some sort of serious misclick there. Ends up running back into Jigabilly, and that will be your first blood. That had to be a misclick, right? Like, he was running away, and all of a sudden, herp derp, right back into Jigabilly.
He's running away. He went boots first so that he could outrun that sort of stuff. Although, you actually have Pandago now grabbing his boots very early. So, you know, you have Jigglebilly coming up. You know he's got a good stun. You've just seen the Mirana rotating through here. There's no way he just walked up. Oh, I can get a little bit more experience. No, that was a misclick.
Well, Cakes, that means he's going to be in a lot better position, though. He's actually being held up here. Frostbite's going to go down. He does have an impale. Hits it up on Benjes, and Benjes doesn't have enough mana, but the last auto attack from Crystal Maiden. I didn't actually think that was going to be enough, considering Nyx Assassin's high amount of base armor. But just barely enough to tick him over the edge, and that means another kill will go the way, or at least even out the kill score for Revenge.
Yeah, see, I'm not exactly known for her powerful auto attacks in the early game.
Yeah.
Or the late game, for that matter.
Yeah.
That's Smash to mid. He's sitting 8-0 against a 9-3 Invoker, and that's, you know, that's not bad at all for a melee hero against Quasvoker, because melee against Cold Snap is the worst thing. If you've never played it, don't. Just avoid it at all costs. It's horrible.
Yeah, fortunately, though, Centaur is known for being pretty good to deal with harassment. I mean, he is a hero that is run offlane of note, just because, you know, being able to pick up that one level return kind of mitigates a lot of that damage. I mean, you don't feel as good getting off those free auto attacks when you're actually having a bit of damage returned to you every single hit. And a big tanky hero like Centaur, especially with that stout shield, when you don't have a whole lot of damage, oftentimes you're taking more from that return than you're actually dishing out if the stout shield procs.
Yeah, but at the same time, you've got Quas, so it's not like you have problems with regen at all.
Oh, yeah,
I think Ryu can be pretty happy just, you know, trying to zone at least a little bit, as long as he's willing to Quas himself up.
Yeah. Actually saying that, as you say that, that was a point I was going to bring up. But I'm a little bit surprised we don't go, no levels of return, right? Like, just maxing out the straight-up nukes, go for a fast blink dagger, and just try and burst down heroes as fast as humanly possible. Because, like you said, with a Quas Invoker, you can get off those auto attacks. You've got that health regen to be able to keep you up. There's not really a big worry there.
Yeah, I mean, it's something I probably would have expected from Smash, but I think it is a little bit safer to have the return, because on top of that, remember he had the Mirana in his lane pretty early? So it means that this has to be a 1v1 lane for it to be useful, as long as he's got the point in return, because, well, the Invoker can harass just fine. Nobody else can. They'll burn off all their regen trying to zone him out.
Mystico and Pandago. Oh, Telekinesis. Oh, he could have ran him up on the cliff, but instead they're just going to go for the kill here. Pandago gets stomped and easily cleaned up with a level 3 double edge. So another kill going the way of revenge. Pandago, not really sure what he was thinking there. I mean, that was so early to make that kind of rotation, but again, I suppose he didn't really count on this one ward making the big difference for revenge.
Yeah. So I'm torn right now on Tranquil Boots for Centaur, because on the one hand, it's by far the best between engagement HP regen you're ever going to get. But when you're in a farming role and when you're, obviously you're going to be getting hit a lot of the time, you're trying to stay up close to people. What do you think about new Tranquils on Centaur? Because I've never actually had that discussion with someone.
I actually don't like it in the mid role. I really, really agree, because there isn't a possibility. Oh, Mystico. He's going to get picked off. They dive into the tier 2 tower to get it, but in the end, they do finally pick up the kill. Oh, the buyback. Oh, Mystico wants it. Fateful, then he got it. Well done by Mystico. Seeing the opportunity, hits that buyback button at 5 minutes in and is able to get a return kill on the Mirana. Because of that, look at this position like Mirana, this Rubick is in. 5 minutes in and is level 5. That is really, really good for a non-traditional offlaner.
Absolutely, and I think, honestly, if they'd maybe managed to get a ward kind of in this region right here, he'd be doing even better, because he never would have gotten caught by any of these ganks. Mm-hmm. So, but just, he is playing very, very well, and it was a very good rotation also coming out of Smash to help him out to make sure they got the pick off on Pandago earlier in the match. That helped him out a lot, too.
But going back to your question about the Tranquil Bullets, I agree, because I have been in that position where, as a Centaur, I'm in, like, a 1v1 scenario where I'm trying to spam out as much double edge as possible, and I immediately think, okay, Tranquil Boots, a really, really good regen. However, when you're in that farming position, you don't actually have the time to pick up any of that regen, because you're not waiting 15 seconds. Like, there's no point in time where you're sitting there for 15 seconds not getting hit and not auto-attacking at all. There are very, very few times you're actually going to be able to have that regen kick into play. That being said, if Smash can start making the rotations around the map, which I think he's planning on doing, level 7, level 8, if he starts moving around the map a little bit, then I can see how that regen will come into play, as well as the vast amount of movement speed. He did just pick up an invis rune, but it looks like Ryu knows exactly what's going on.
Oh, so he's just going to use it with that movement speed to try and get up to top lane. It's a 2v2 at the moment, so that overload could really set something up, especially if he gets this early stun on Cakes before he gets the Carapace off.
Oh, he's in a
position.
Just backed
up just in time.
Yeah, Cakes. Oh, now he comes forward, and there goes. Pops the ultimate, and going to be able to easily clean up Cakes. Amasheep does get a good arrow on, of all heroes, of course, the Centaur, making this a little bit more difficult. Smash, he knows he can't get hit by that EMP, so he dives in deeper, but it just means he's going to go down to the cold snap. Ben just now trying to get away from Ryu, as well as Amasheep. Arrow's going to be up, and it won't land on Benji's. Barely able to keep alive, thanks to FaZe Boots, and now the turnaround. Mihawk catches out Ryu, and will be able to pick up that kill. Just another auto attack, anything. Oh, just a little bit of fire even. He's surrounded by fire on all sides, yet Revenge don't know where he's at. He's just sitting there. Finally, the fire will tick away, which means Ryu will be able to just walk away for free, nothing being able to stop him, because we don't even have Flame Guard either. That's another point to talk about. Revenge, we're going to see more of a Sing Sing build up on this Ember Spirit. No Flame Guard early on.
I think this build makes a perfect amount of sense when you're just sitting in a lane farming, because yeah, you want Sleight of Fist up so you can spam it out as easily as possible in the low cooldowns once you actually do have your items, and you don't need to worry about pushing up the lane with the Flame Guard, trying to play lane control with that. Your lane control is handled by your supports, so you'll be fine. Just, you know, get the Sleight of Fist, get the Searing Chains. You can always make the damage happen later. And then the Flame Guard you'll be mostly using for its protective elements later in the game as opposed to its offensive ones. Ooh, Masoku is in so
rotations.
Much trouble. Nyx Assassin.
With Cakes being able to set up that with a Vendetta, Stud, and then very, very easily following that up with an arrow. eHug get a small pickoff, but nothing too big. But at the same time, Smash is also wasting a lot of his time at this bottom lane. I'm not entirely sure about his rotation into bottom. Like, you're not gonna really gonna be able to shut down this Wraith King without excessive numbers to your gank. Like, there's just no way, because he has the double life like that. It just takes so much commitment from Revenge. So Smash, he does have his ultimate if he wants to be able to get aggressive onto this Invoker, but at the same time, Ryu, he's just probably going to be waiting there with the Cold Snap, EMP, and even the Tornado to be able to follow that up, that he's ready for any sign of aggression coming out from that Centaur.
Yeah, they'd probably need Masoku to actually initiate things, because if you have to spend any time running in, you're just going to get Tornadoed.
Well, right now, let's take a look at that gold lead. Because it feels pretty even. In fact, that's exactly what it is. 100 gold to eHug's name right now and about 200 experience going the way of Revenge. So very, very close game so far, 4-4. But taking a look at the net worth, we have Jigglebilly way far out ahead, and that's to be expected. He did go for a minus where we don't see one up on Revenge at all. However, we do have a very, very early Blink Dagger already up on Mihawk. And once Smash gets his, this like 15-minute mark, I think, is when Revenge have the biggest opening to really just move around the map and crush eHug. But we've said that before, haven't we, Hippie? Only the two games in a row have we said 15 to 25-minute mark is when Revenge is really going to be able to get very, very aggressive. They have this great lineup to shut down the enemy team. And they faltered both times. Cakes at top gets caught out by the counter ward, but fortunately with a good spike, Carapace is able to deflect a decent amount of the damage, and Mirana backing him up as well means there's just no actual pursuit by Revenge.
Yeah, I think, honestly, you...
There goes that combo. Ultimate is going to be dropped by Jigglebilly. The turnaround, though, the ult... Oh, stun gets thrown on Jigglebilly, but it doesn't matter. As Pandago comes in, I'm not entirely sure what they expected, though, out of that attempted gank on a Wraith King, who hasn't died, who hasn't used his ultimate yet at all. Like, of course he's still going to have his ultimate, and of course that's going to be a bad trade. Again, you have to use, like, three or four heroes to ensure gank on that guy, because you know there's going to be at least one support around the table, if not more, coming in with teleports.
Yeah, I think they were really relying on getting one more stun on Jigglebilly when he got back up. The Rubick actually had the Wraith Fire Blast stolen, which obviously is a very, very easy steal, only thing you can get from him. So you can actually... You can very reliably have a double stun Rubick in this game, but there was just too much coming in on the other side. Oh, Jigglebilly, you're...
EMP going down, trying to burn through some of that mana on these supports, and he gets both of them. However, they're backing up. Tier 1 tower goes down. Jigglebilly, he's going to lose his life as he goes down to the fire. Ember Spirit going to be able to clean him up. Supports on the back. Oh, Crystal Maiden almost going down to that tornado. Mihawk trying to get more kills for this Ember Spirit. Going to give away his life in the process, but Ben just keeps on going for it. Has a sleight of fist and will be able to use it on Pandago, but might give away his life. He's very, very low. Cakes on the pursuit. 6 seconds for a stun, but not going to be able to have it. And with that, oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. Benjes turns around and completely throws away that one because he couldn't get into the wards. That was why. I see that now. I was like, why did he turn around? I completely forgot about the wards being set up from earlier.
Yeah, one swing of that entire set of wards and he would have been done anyway. There were no creeps to tank it up for him. And even then, you have to imagine Pandago was sitting there like, come on, come on, come at me, buddy. Because you know that feeling, right? When you die on a Shadow Shaman, mm-hmm. And you're just like, all right, my wards are down. I can still kill everybody.
Yeah, exactly. And you've got nothing better to do than micro wards. So there's just no possibility of an Ember Spirit being able to just walk past those. So looks like interesting build go coming out from him. Looks like he's going to be going for a fast Crystallis on his Ember Spirit, because he's got an extra Blades of Attack. Jump in, though, from the Batrider. Centaur ultimate being used, and look at that positioning. Instantly, four heroes on top of the three from eHug as they try and respond to the Batrider. That is the power of the Batrider-Centaur combo.
That is pretty brutal. I don't think I've actually seen that in professional play before, but Arrow's going to hit benches right there, but I don't think they care. All that's sitting there trying to zone is the Mirana, but I'm not sure they have the damage to take this tower.
Yeah, possibility. I mean, they do have the sustain to sit there and siege down the tower, but you're right. Very, very low on the physical damage right now. Centaur taking it up. Arrow going to go down, not going to be able to land. And now they do take the tower, but they're in a bad position because of it. Pandago gets stomped, though, and Smash cleans them up real quickly. Ryu comes in with a good tornado. They're going to be able to pick off Smash in exchange for that. That was still Tier 1 tower. And a support in exchange for that middle Centaur. Not the greatest exchange in the world for revenge. However, does get a little bit more gold going the way of that Ember Spirit. And you do want him to snowball as fast as humanly possible.
Yeah, I'm not sure I'm a huge fan of the Drums Crystallist build, but then again, he is going to get away with it because the Drums will give him the extra stats he need to get that spam done. He's sitting on already 600 mana, which so long as he's not spamming a lot of Remnants, obviously that's what's burning through the majority of your mana pool at 150 in activation. As long as he's mostly using Sleight of Fist, mostly using Searing Chains, he should be okay, just working with what he's got right now. Arrow fired, gonna miss for my Mischief. Tornado stolen by Misko, gonna catch Jiggle Billy.
Oh, the Centaur ultimate goes down, but a great tornado from Ryo puts them in a good position. However, the Batrider was still able to find that support Mirana and kill him, and they do get a deny on the tower. Meanwhile, Crystal Maiden, oh, sorry, buddy, but you're going to go down. Pandago should be using wards for this, but instead just going to use a leash and try and wait for Jigability to try and get in range. Misoku may have the opportunity. Not even the close. Pandago gets off that second Aether Shock and cleans up the kill. So no wards being committed, meaning they might be able to use it and try and pressure this top tier 1 tower as they have forced most of revenge back to the base.
Yeah, I mean, obviously we were talking about previously in previous games trying to force out big ultimates in fights and holding on to that in particular, not overcommitting those big pushing ultimates to little engagements like that is an important part of playing these kinds of heroes because you have to have that ultimate ready to commit. Otherwise, I mean, say it's like an Enigma or a Shadow Shaman or a Death Prophet, when their ultimates are down, the other team feels so much more confident in picking fights with you. Right now, they have to worry, okay, we can get this going, but is a Shadow Shaman ward set going to wreck us?
Top, we have a 4v3 going on. Actually, Cakes is going to join the fight as well. Ben just caught inside the wards and quickly burst it down. And this is bad for revenge. They're going to try and back up here. Jigabilly looking for that stun. Still has his ultimate to be able to fall back on. I mean, your first step of trying to initiate being jumping on a Wraith King, not a great start. Now they're going to go for more here. Ben just gets a nice chance though, and here comes the nukes. Drops them on both of those heroes, and now the Centaur in pursuit. Finding Jigabilly will be able to pick him off. Cakes, though, gets a nice kill on the Rubick. Good stun as well, preventing the chain on Amashi. Meanwhile, Jigabilly uses his first life and soon going to lose the second one. Gets the stun off on Misoku, which will be able to allow Cakes to finish him off. But this is still Jigabilly going down. Maybe they can go for more here as Cakes positions himself to try and get aggressive here. But I'm very, very surprised as Revenge. I think they're the ones that could easily turn this against two very, very squishy support heroes like that. And Centaur still at completely full health. I have no idea what gave Cakes the bravery to think he could continue moving forward. But fortunately, Revenge just going to back off and continuing their farm.
Yeah, that was a buyback used on each side. So in the end, probably very, very favorable for Revenge. Obviously, the Ember Spirit got several kills in spite of the fact that he was the one who had to buy back. And then the Shadow Shaman buyback, I think, was why would he think about doing that? His wards were already down. He wasn't going to get in range. The fight was already kind of breaking up. Just kind of wasted gold coming out from Pandago right there. Very, very unfortunate for eHug because, I mean, obviously, he's playing support. You're not expecting him to get really farmed, but you'd like him to be able to pick up some hit points. Obviously, Shadow Shaman's strength gain is absolutely horrendous, just 1.6, so he doesn't tank up well naturally at all. And if he gets picked off in these fights before his wards go down, if his big initiations, Jigglebilly in the meantime.
Centaur ultimate going down, and they know Jigglebilly does not have his ultimate, and this is a great time for them to gank him. Jigglebilly can do nothing but just throw down a stun, and maybe they can get more here. Tornado going down. They're actually going to try and turn this, but they don't realize there's more heroes coming in. Smash leading the charge, finding the blink. Oh, he misses a stun! Smash with an uncharacteristic misplay there. Completely whiffs and now going to try and continue to go for Pandago, but a well-placed arrow holds him in place. Now Benjes continues to go for more, has a sleight of fist, but is losing out on mana. Wards being dropped, Benjes and the rest of his team going to cop a bit of damage and they all have to back away. Smash, if they try and go through this choke point, it might be an opportunity for Smash to turn on him. Thinking about it right now, Mirana is actually going to be picked off, or excuse me, Crystal Maiden's going to be picked off by the Marana, who had no hope of being able to get out of that one, apparently. Completely missed Crystal Maiden being left behind in the pool as Revenge backed away.
Yeah, and just Misko getting picked off at the start of this. He's one of their, you know, very valuable heroes. You have a lot of really great steals coming out from eHug. If you can get anything from the Shadow Shaman, anything from the Nyx, the Invoker. I mean, I mentioned it in the previous game, how good the steals were for the Rubick. In this game as well, there's really not a lot of bad spells to pick up, especially if you pick up the Invoker spells. Those are ridiculous to just kind of grab and then toss away as soon as you've used them. Mm-hmm. Because they're so good, obviously, limited by the cooldown, but you can just grab a different spell as soon as it's on cooldown.
Yeah, the greatest thing is their high amount of damage. Misoku, though, oh, if they can get Jigabilly a third time, this is going to be huge. He does still have his ultimate. He's going to try and output as much damage on the Crystal Maiden as possible before he goes down. Arrow's going to land on Misoku. That means he's going to go down. Jigabilly's going to clean him up. Stun goes out. Now here comes Cakes, getting a good stun on Benjis, holding him in place, and he has no more mana to continue on. Mystico getting very, very low, but Cakes, he can't pursue. Stun the turnaround. Meanwhile, Benjis trying to get away. He has no mana. The rest of the pursuit coming in. Cakes trying to throw down a little bit of a stun. He has that double damage, but just can't keep on going. And the double edge goes down. Smash finishes him off. Good arrow thrown by Marana, but it's not enough. Pandago, he's going to get caught out as well. Benjis gets close enough to be able to be a part of the experience of yet another kill as the Smash Centaur. Centaur, man, has really been a hero this month that has been performing like crazy. This hero is extremely strong right now in the meta, and we're seeing exactly why in the hands of Smash.
Absolutely. I mean, it just enables so much aggression, and the Batrider in particular, just there's, you don't even need to go in for the early four staff. That EMP is going to burn away all of Smash's mana, so they might want to worry a little bit. He gets booted, but at the same time, he's got one stomp, and then he's out of this.
Yeah,
they just need to back up.
Yeah, Ryu's just throwing down enough pressure to be able to back him off that tier one tower. But immediately, Revenge are turning this into more aggression. They're going to find Jigabilly here. Ultimate being used at that bottom lane. Spenge is getting picked off at top. Mystico going to be found as well as they interrupt him. Back to bottom, though. Looks like Jigabilly just getting kited around. Our Mystico will fall eventually. Back at bottom, though. Jigabilly turning the fight now, going up against Mihawk as Amasheep joins the fight. Push back. Frostbite trying to get Mihawk away. He's going to try and teleport. Misoku is going to give up his life in exchange for that. I like the idea of them going in. Finally, they do get Jigabilly, though. Smash makes his rotation to the bottom lane, finally, and cleans him up. So it is finally worth it. They shut down Jigabilly once again. This guy has no relief whatsoever from Revenge. They are just constantly hunting him down.
Yeah, I mean, one of the problems with Wraith King is once he's... What are you going to do if he gets picked off alone? He doesn't really have a lot of a response to that. And in general, as soon as he's getting focused, as soon as he doesn't have any help, he's not a particularly useful hero. He needs his whole team to kind of set up fights, control distances for him, make sure that nobody's kiting him out. As soon as he can get kited around, you saw until I'm a Sheep showed up on that Marana.
Top.
You just had...
We have Batrider trying to get away. Firefly barely able to get out. A Pandago was just searching for that one disable, but couldn't get it.
Yeah, just finishing up, you could see there was so much kiting going on from that Wraith King. Until the Marana got there, he was completely unable to lock down the Batrider or even the Crystal Maiden because there was so much slow going down on him. Crystal Maiden, who has pretty piss-poor move speed if she's taken any damage recently. You know, she's got the Tranquils, obviously, but she'll lose a lot of that move speed when she gets hit. But the sticky napalm, just good movement for both heroes, and he was running in circles.
Yeah, I mean, he's pretty much a much, much worse version of a Lifestealer. Like, yeah. Lifestealer at least can go magic immune to make sure you don't get kited by abilities, and it's only those physical abilities as well as, like, any sort of escape mechanisms that really kite you around middle, though. Mama Sheep pops a good leap just in time, but still, the pursuit continues. Benji is going to catch an arrow right to the back, but it doesn't seem to matter as only Jigabilly is here, and we've seen what happens when... Jigabilly gets surrounded by three heroes. He just constantly gets kited. Maybe if he gets a good crit here. Leads with one crit. Now going to continue going on. Frostbite goes out. No! Takes out from the nuke. As Jigabilly gets rather lucky here with that first hit crit. Meanwhile, top Centaur actually gets picked off as the duo of the Nyx Assassin as well as the Invoker invade the enemy jungle and find a free Centaur to be able to pick off. Great pickoff for them because he was well on his way to Shiva's.
Yeah, obviously getting his hands on that Sheev is just, that would screw the Wraith King so much more as well. He's not a hero with really great attack speed, so the aura is pretty frustrating for him. And on top of that, talking about how easily he gets kited, having that big AoE slow, because he has to be close in. He's, and first of all, it's hard to miss that on the center anyway. The ward steal!
Oh,
gonna be
no.
A ward fight coming out.
It's
that's
just
gonna ruin
means,
that push completely.
Yeah, exactly. It just means the wards are gonna be taken down by the other wards, and really with nothing, like nobody's in real danger then by addressing the wards. That was a pretty bad giveaway. And Mystico, if he wants to, he's definitely got the timer for his ultimate, especially at level 2. He can hold on to these Mass Serpent wards if he wants to. In fact, that was exactly what I would do in this situation. Hold on to Mass Serpent wards and maybe even do something like take Roshan with it.
Well, just even if you can't take Roshan or a tower with it, just having it in the next team fight so you can counter drop Serpent Wards, that's a big deal, man. I mean, those are such incredibly powerful area control tools. And being able to just drop them down, be like, all right, you want to fight under your wards? You're fighting under our wards, too. And then, you know, it's a little bit of a fight to see who can clear wards faster. But you'd think that the team that's dropping the response wards would actually be in better shape for that because they know exactly what's coming. Mm-hmm. Oh, Jiggle Billy wants to get Benjos.
Yeah,
but
they're rotating.
So much more coming.
They're rotating a lot of heroes down here. If they could burst them down. Oh, excellent stun from Cakes. Blinks in and gets that maxed out impale just in time. Now Mihawk even being held in place by the spike carapace. Very nicely done by Cakes there. And good initiation from eHug. Revenge were doing a good job fighting. But these last couple of minutes, things have really soured for them so far. They're not really turning this Centaur again. Like, he had some really good early on aggression, but as we start moving into the mid game, he is really beginning to suffer quite a bit.
Well, he's got his Sheevas now, so let's see if that has an effect on the next fight.
I can't believe he's thinking about going for this at 550 health, thinking about going for the dive on Ryu. Oh no, he just wants the tier 1 tower from now though, but still a good tornado EMP is going to put him very, very low. They want to be able to make some sort of trade, though, for the tier 2 going down at bottom. Ward's being thrown down just to be able to finish off that tier 1 tower, and they immediately run away. Jigabilly, though, he's trying to find Mystico. Mystico hiding himself on the side, but Tornado gives enough vision to be able to throw down the stun, and that means he will go down. Centaur ultimate or no, he's still going to go down. Actually, Smash, he's going to go in. Sheevas and everything being used. Ryu, just one more hit, and he finally gets it, but he will trade away his life as Jigabilly going to be able to ensure Pandago is actually the one who picks up the last hit. But still, a trade and not really what you want to see right now, is I don't really see Revenge being ahead right now when it comes to late game. I looking at this Ember Spirit, he has no item progression whatsoever. Even though I feel that Ember Spirit might be a little bit of a stronger carry than Wraith King, not with these sort of items, and especially not with a strong hero like Invoker being able to back up that Wraith King.
Yeah, if you want to talk about semi-carries, Centaur versus Invoker, I think we all know who wins that particular fight.
Mm-hmm.
And on top of that, I feel like the supports for eHug scale a little bit better into the late game. You have a lot of disabling power coming out in particular. And disables, of course, when you're less high on magic damage, in the late game, you absolutely want to be able to lock down every single hero possible. So you have really great stun coming out from the Nyx. He actually still puts out good damage in the late game. The Serpent Wards in particular really scale quite well. And while you do have some pretty okay scaling from the Crystal Maiden, you can get some good steals on the Rubick. It's not quite as reliable as just having, okay, we have these Serpent Wards. We have, you know, Mirana, who can start dealing some physical damage. She's got herself a Yasha and an Aqua Ring. She's going for a Manta style. Whereas, you know, the Crystal Maiden, it's reliant on, oh, I have to not get stunned against a team where every single hero has a disable for her to really be valuable in a late game team fight.
Bottom, we have possible action both in the jungle and at bottom. Ryu is actually going to go for this. Gets the tornado up on the Crystal Maiden, and there's no way Masoka's making it out. Pandago, with a beautiful play, actually turns and gets the shackles up on Mystico, but I don't think they're going to be able to turn this. Middle, though, Cakes being smashed up on Jigabilly, and Cakes are trying to take him down a notch, and they do still have that ultimate for Jigabilly. They can freely dive if they want to. Back at the bottom lane, eHug and the rest of them are trying to make their pursuit in. Mihawk has the Firefly. If he could just get over the cliffs, but Cakes, another good spike carapace thrown down against the Batrider. Meanwhile, they do get the Rubick there. as Pandago with the four staff, it looks like, was able to find the disables on the Rubick and hold them in place. And those three pickoffs mean a tier two as well as a ton of map control are going the way of eHug. And I'm tempted to say that revenge, I find it very, very hard to see how they're going to be able to come back in this game, especially, again, looking at this Ember and going, where are the items? If you only have one big item, and he doesn't even have that yet, but once he has that Daedalus, great. You have a Daedalus, but you have no damage to be able before that Daedalus, right? Like, normally, there's Daedalus is your third or second or third pickup on most carries, especially Ember's Spirit. You want to be able to see some sort of damage before that. Just a Daedalus doesn't ensure you're going to be able to one-shot heroes.
Well, you have to remember that with the plus 120, oh, initiation going out on Jigglebilly, they get a nice lasso and they pull him in.
Now they're holding him in place. Jigglebilly does still have that ultimate. He's freely just outputting a bunch of damage. Misoku, he's going to get picked off. Cakes with the Blinken will be able to ensure he goes down. Now they just have to see if they can kite him around. Oh, Ember Spirit. He jumps to one of his remnants, finally gets back into the base, takes an arrow to the face, though. Jigglebilly gets four staff up, and Benjes may get bursted down here. He's losing all of his mana. Vendetta hit Cakes, not able to finish the job, but a good spike carapace gets him away. There goes that Scotty, though. Smash slows down everyone, ensures the pursuit. If he could just get a little bit more. Amashii fighting up against it. Arrow actually does land on Smash. The question is, can he finish him? One auto attack, two. He gets it and will be able to successfully trade away his life and get Smash, which is a huge pickoff. On top of that, they already got that range Rex, which is a huge advantage for them. 29 minutes into the game, they have an AC as well as a Vlad's up on Wraith King, plus another 1,300 gold, and he may just find a courier too.
He's just the aura monster right now. Just quickly, oh yeah, he's looking for it. He gets the one swing, two swing, and it's down. Just more gold. Oh, is he going to trade? No, his reincarnate just came back up.
Oh, perfect. They're going to think, oh, we got this kill easily, and all of a sudden, reincarnate. Now they have to kite him around a second time. There's nobody nearby, though, so it should be pretty easy. Frostbite going down. They have Searing Chains, even a lasso being used. Sticky Napalm especially is just so bad for a Wraith King when he's left alone like that. There's just literally nothing you can do unless you get some sort of misplay and a couple of lucky crits. You can't even trade yourself or someone else.
Yeah, it does mean there's 2.5 minutes before that Daedalus comes out on Benjes, though, because that entire thing was on the courier.
Oh, man.
So that's very unfortunate. I will say quickly, I keep getting cut off by team fights again. I thought I told you to tell them to stop team fighting
I'm sorry. You know, I will try. Next time, I'll pause the game. I'll just be like, guys, Hippie needs to finish his thought first.
All right. Thank you. I appreciate that. Now I know that I'm loved around here. But just when you think about... So your average damage item is adding like 60 to 80 damage. If it's something like a Desolator, it's more effective damage than that, obviously. But, you know, just talking about raw damage amounts, maybe 80 to 100 on something really good. Sleight of Fist is 120. So since most of his auto attack damage is coming from Sleight of Fists, I think going a raw Daedalus actually isn't that big of a deal because you are critting that extra 120.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a good point. It's just still the fact that, like, okay, we're only dealing with one big item coming out from the Ember Spirit. Like, I guess I'm okay with the first item being a Daedalus. It's just still, for me, the fact that we only got one damage item. Meanwhile, like, the Wraith King, he's got an AC, which is a little bit bigger, plus Vlad's, and, like, all these extra items that he has. And you know he's going to be able to farm up really, really well because it's a Wraith King. Like, you're able to farm up pretty aggressively. On top of that, Ryu, he's got a Scythe of Ice, man. That guy is pretty farmed up as well.
Yeah, and he's going to... Jigglebilly has not only 30 armor with all these items, but when he maxes out that Vampiric Aura, which he's actually been taking stats a lot over that, he's got 6 points in stats. If he decides to max that out, he's got, you know, 46% lifesteal.
Yeah,
which
casual.
Is kind of ridiculous.
Yeah.
You put a Satanic on, you know, he's fine.
Yeah,
I would like him to pick up a Desolator, quite frankly. I think the extra minus armor would help a lot because Ember doesn't actually... He's not a hero with a lot of armor in spite of being agility, and neither is anybody else on that team except for Smash with his Shivas. And, of course, the building breaking potential would just go through the roof.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Just mean Jigglebilly could sit on the front line and beat on towers and, and actually use that those hits to really do a devastating amount of damage. Yeah, there goes the Warth being thrown down. Jigabilly, he's going to get brought back deep into the enemy base, and they're going to try and tear him apart inside there. There goes that first ultimate, though. The rest of the team just focusing on the racks. They know they can't really do much to save Jigabilly. Tornado being thrown down, trying to help him out now, and really great deafening blast as well. They do clean up the racks. The question is anybody going to go down? Good force staff for Pandago. Double force staff is going to be able to bring him out of reach. Ooh, just barely. As Ember Spirit came forward, wasn't able to get a critical. Still, though, that isn't that bad. I mean, considering the ranged racks is already down. You know, losing a melee racks, obviously that's the important racks, but you also got to clean up some wards, and it could have been much, much worse. This just means Revenge can hold on for a little bit longer.
Yeah, but I mean, if your only, like, kind of good moments are coming when they push uphill into your base, and you kind of just let your carry die to get the racks, and you still get a kill out of it, because they got Masoku on top of that. It's not like they actually lost Jigglebilly, it was just the reincarnate, so there's literally no loss for eHug, and I don't see this getting much better for Revenge unless they can make a miracle happen.
Yeah, it's going to have to be one of those, like, really, really late. Hey, it's going to be them turtling for another 15 minutes, Ember Spirit getting absolutely huge, and then them also outplaying eHug going into the late game. That's really going to be it, because Invoker, you already said it, like, the support's coming out from eHug, very, very strong. The offlaner, still just as strong as the Batrider, and then we have an Invoker triumphing over a Batrider. There's so many late-game scenarios here for eHug. That follow-up, oh, quick sight device, and now Smash being held in place. Arrow's going to be missed because of the tornado, but it won't seem to matter. He's going to go down. Good stun being landed by Mystico, but it's not enough. Here comes the Ember Spirit, though, trying to output as much damage as possible. Sure, they take down Jigglypuff once, but how are you going to take him down twice? Is now they're on the retreat, being held up, and here comes that physical damage. Good telekinesis, keeping Jigglypuff from being able to hit as much as possible. Cakes gets another stun up on, and now Mystico will fall as well. The attempt at a teleport away by Benjes barely gets out before Cakes can finish him off, but you said it, man. If your best fights are happening when eHug are going up into your base, when the team fight is occurring around, like, your tier fours, and it wasn't even that good of a team fight, how are you actually going to make regular team fights, you know, that you don't have such a big advantage? How are you going to make those go your way? And it seems it's just kind of impossible for Revenge.
Yeah, I mean, there's so much good warding coming out from Revenge on their side of the map. Like, they have all these defensive wards to let them farm up, but it just feels like eHug doesn't give them any space. Even with all that good space, there's so much constant pressure on towers, on heroes, wherever you're going. Honestly, I think that bottom was a bait. You know, you saw Imasheep just kind of farming right there. Ryu was just sitting below the tower, thinking, all right, someone's going to go for him. I'll get the instant sheep. They were so ready for that. Oh, man. And now Ryu's sitting on level 18 on his Invoker. You have Jigglebilly at 21. He's actually decided not to level the Vampiric Aura. I don't think I've actually checked since the aura's been reworked. Does it stack with Vlad's Lifesteal or not? I'm not sure it does.
It's got to, right?
Like, I mean, you'd think so. Why else would he get the Vlad's? I mean, obviously the damage is okay. It's the percentage damage. But I'm not seeing the buff showing up on him. Like, I see the Vladdy's buff. Mm-hmm. I don't see the Vampiric Aura buff.
Cakes, he got picked off there. Good awareness by Revenge there, just being able to throw down some counter wards and finally pick off their Nyx Assassin. I think they really are feeling the pressure right now. They're going to smoke up, get aggressive, move out, and see if they can turn one pick off into two, into three, and maybe even be able to take some map control. Smash runs forward, doesn't even get an auto attack. That's the one thing I really, really love about Centaur. Return doing damage to buildings is the most hilarious thing ever to me.
It's true. It's pretty great. You can't say no to that. So now, all right. I really do think that this is Revenge's best chance to get some towers back. But at the same time, I don't know. Oh, Mystico TP'd back. I don't actually like that. I think he can get picked off so easily by Ryu.
Yeah, there's just no way. Well,
he's got Vendetta. Okay.
Vendetta is a good start. But that's still pretty risky. He's going to be playing around Ryu. See if they can have any more teleports to be able to set this up. But they have no idea, like, exactly what's behind Ryu. Right now, it's just a Morana. But for all they know, there could be a lot more. And that's why they're bringing everyone in force. Ryu going to get caught out. Nicely done. Easily being able to clean him up. And there goes that Aegis. And should be a second kill as well, as there's just no possibility of escape.
Well, you know, good setup by Revenge. You said that, you know, they got the pickoff on Cakes. They were looking for another pickoff. Maybe they didn't get one in bottom, but they had a very good rotation to top. And, I mean, we talked about, okay, this is looking really good for eHug, but Wraith King, and if you want to talk Wraith King versus Ember Spirit, Ember Spirit is pretty incredibly devastating in the ultra late game. I mean, I'm talking about how good all these supports are in the late game, how much control they have. None of that matters if you get to the point where the Ember Spirit just kills everyone in two sleight of fists. I mean, what are you going to do about that? And he's going for a second Daedalus, which I don't love. That I would have liked to see it be a Desolator. There's so many armor auras already. Maybe the Desolator wouldn't have really done very much. Just because you're already working against all this bonus armor. You have high armor heroes in general with the Mirana and the Nyx. I don't know. I honestly don't know what I would have liked out of Benja's, but probably not a Daedalus again.
Yeah. I don't know if you've seen that stat about the Battle Furies. I think it was up on Reddit. The Battle Furies up on Ember Spirit, and it was showing like how basically that saying three Battle Furies was actually better than being able to pick up a Daedalus. Now, that's pretty situational in what they were talking about because it relies heavily on being able to get that splash damage. And the critical effect is not just about the overall damage, but also the potential to be able to burst down one hero very quickly. So I do believe Daedalus is a much more important item, but that does kind of go to show you the power of damage on an Ember Spirit. Honestly, I would just prefer a Battle Fury over a Daedalus. If you're going to go for a second Daedalus, I would prefer just the damage of a Battle Fury right now and being able to just go in for late game. I know Battle Fury 38 minutes in, it's not great, but it's still really good damage. It works well with your sleight of fist, and just go for late game. Is Masoku going to get caught out, but a double stun by Smash might just lead things a little bit better. Oh, look at that crit. Cleaning up a couple of supports, putting them very, very low, but not quite enough to finish them. Now another one. Another sleight of fist goes down, doesn't get the critical on Cakes, meaning he will survive. Vendetta gets him out. Smash trying to buy room for his supports. Benji's does clean up the Nyx Assassin finally with a good sleight of fist. Jigabelly, though, getting kited around. Halberd holds him in place, and he loses one life. Here comes the second one. Arrow going to be up on Mihawk. Question is, can they kite around Jigabelly enough? He does have a little bit of support here. Jigabelly held in place, and they will get a second stun. Tornado, is it going to clean up? He does get the Rubick at least. Smash getting very, very low as well. But oh, Mirana doing a lot of damage with that Desolator, turning a lot of damage on herself as well. Gets an arrow on Mihawk, able to finish him off. At the same time, though, Ryo able to get away, and somehow the team fight does go well for Revenge as they lose what? Two heroes in exchange for cleaning up four of eHug. That is an amazing turnaround.
Crystal Maiden died really early.
Oh, that's right. That's right. Forgot
about
that.
Still, absolutely. I'm in agreement. That was a fantastic fight for them. They kept Benjis alive for the whole thing. So he's getting good gold out of this. He's going to be able to finish the second Daedalus, even if we don't think that's optimal. It's still a second item that he has going up from now, and we'll see what he goes into next for his damage. I was going to say, you know, just go whole hog, get a Divine Rapier. It would be funny at the very least, but, you know, probably not the single best choice he could make.
Actually, but I'm all for that. Honestly, really, I am straight up for that.
Actually, he's holding on to the money. He might do it.
I am straight up for
that. He's doing
it. Yeah. I like that a lot more because you have the Crystalis going well with the Daedalus. Like, that critical combo is fine. Like, stacking Daedalus is a little for me. But just having the, like, basic Crystalis and not building that extra bit of gold into the Daedalus and just go for Divine, absolutely. I mean, you're watching the way. This is the power of an Ember Spirit, is that you don't have to put yourself in danger and still have the possibility to one-shot supports and that sort of thing. You saw the way Ben just played that. He sat back, threw a sleight of fist, didn't engage. Threw a sleight of fist, didn't engage. Like, he constantly sat back and just threw a sleight of fist. That is the perfect kind of mentality for a Divine Rapier kind of build. Like, it makes sure that you never put yourself in any real danger.
Well, yeah, and on top of that, Divine Rapier is particularly good on anyone who's hitting multiple heroes with each auto attack. I mean, when we think of traditional Rapier heroes who might go in for a Desperation Rapier, we're thinking Gyrocopter, we're thinking Medusa, we're thinking Luna, heroes like that. Sleight of Fist works just as well for something like that. And it's just very, very safe damage, like you're talking about. You can play very careful, and you can just basically have defensive remnants down so you can just get out, out, out. He's doing it, I think.
Yep, here it comes.
It's going.
Got it.
Oh, here we go, baby. Now the game is real. Everything up until now, this has been a practice match. Now there's a rapier.
Yep, yeah, you're absolutely right. Now all of a sudden, like, this is actually very, very even, despite the fact that looking at it, like, 8,000 gold lead right now for eHug, a 10,000 experience lead. That has been dropping, and now I would put it even, just because, like, the gold investment into a rapier It's why it's sort of like that last-ditch maneuver. Sure, it's very, very risky, but the amount of money you put into a rapier, no other item can compete with that kind of efficiency of gold to damage, right? There's just no way you can compete with that. So now a Divine Rapier, in my mind, this is very, very even match. 38 to 31, the stats may not look that even, but in my mind, especially since Revenge has actually been able to turn the last couple of team fights to their favor, now with the Divine Rapier, things just got a lot more interesting.
Yeah, just quick trivia for you guys out there since Dahaz isn't there. If you're not taking into account slot considerations, there's one item with better gold to damage than Divine Rapier,
and that's actually
Slippers of Agility on Agility Heroes. It's actually somewhat better DPS than Divine Rapier for the same amount of gold. However, you only have 6 slots.
And by that logic, there's 2 other items, right? Ironwood Branch.
Ironwood Branch. Yeah.
Especially since it's no longer 53 gold, but 50
gold cost instead of 53.
Yeah,
there you go.
So that means you're getting all 3 of those stats. Regeneration. Cakes right now.
Thanks for ruining my trivia.
Because I was actually going to say it. Oh, the initiation, though. Ultimate Gump being laid down. They're actually trying to lock down Ryu on the side. But meanwhile, Gigabelly in close quarters with everyone right now. There goes that ultimate smash. He's just trying to slow down everybody, but they're targeting him. Divine is on the ground, and they're going to be able to clean it up. E-Hug, they just wiped away the Divine pickup. Revenge somehow taking so many team fights and winning them time after time after time. Pick up the Divine Rapier and lose the team fight horribly. And somehow it's still on the ground. And it doesn't seem to matter, though. Revenge call GG.
I don't think eHug even noticed there was a rapier.
I don't think so either.
I think they just thought they got crit and they just left the rapier there. Maybe that's exactly what can happen, man. It's the risk of a rapier. If your next team fight goes bad, you just lost the game. But sometimes you just got to man up and pick it up. And I do actually think it was a perfectly okay decision.
Yeah, I do too. I think it was absolutely, I just a little bit surprised there that they put themselves at such close quarter with the Wraith King, especially with the way they tried to initiate there. I mean, they had the Batrider jumping in, the BKB preemptively popped, they had the Centaur ultimate, they had all that kind of movement speed, and yet they still got caught really, really close quarters with the Wraith King and with the disables of the Shadow Shaman, which is exactly what you didn't want to see. You wanted to see Batrider going in, bringing in a disabling up, and bringing in one of those very, very squishy heroes, preferably the Invoker, right? Because he's such a heavy disabler. Bring him in into the rest of the heroes where the Sleight of Fist goes down and where Smash is clearing so much room for you with the Stomp, with the Slow, like everything else, just being able to buy space for the Ember Spirit to sit back, Sleight of Fist, back up. Sleight of Fist back up. And instead, they just kind of like all ran in and just kind of like man-fighted up against eHug, and it promptly lost very, very quickly in the team fight.
Yeah. Well, you know, still, that was a damn exciting game. Revenge really looked like they were going to run it back for a little bit there, and I was very excited to see that happen.
Yeah. Well, it was a shame. I really wanted to see Revenge make a comeback here, especially since it's been such a rough night for them. That them picking up a Divine Rapier, I was like, yes, Revenge, you could do it. I believe in you guys. And then no. They just no. Well, guys, that's going to be it for the night. Revenge do not win a single game in the MLG TKO. And now it's going to take a serious miracle. I'm actually not sure how many matches they have left in the TKO. Let me check that out real quick and see what the record is. They are now 0-6. So they have to actually face up against, I'm not sure who they face up against next. It's going to be Team Liquid. If they could take 2 games off of Team Liquid and eHug drop all of their games up against Liquid, Cloud9, and Evil Geniuses, they may have a chance. They'll be tied up, and then we go into those extra rules, see where it goes. But actually, as I say that, I realize that that actually doesn't matter because the bottom 2 teams do get KO'd. So eHug, they have to actually win some games in order to beat Team Liquid out. That's going to be their main hope. Meanwhile, for Sweet Revenge, they're pretty much guaranteed to lose. There is no way they're able to come back from this. So that is the sad story for the Peruvians. They had a good run in the first stage where they went 3-4, had some decent matches here and there, and were able to get into stage 2. Congrats on them, but they only have 1 more series left, and that's up against Team Liquid, and that is pretty much mute for now. Actually, as I say that, they already face Team Liquid. I'm getting my matches completely messed up. So they either have to face up against Evil Geniuses or Cloud9. Either one is going to be a really, really tough match. And even if they do win it, they're pretty much still out of the tournament. So, sorry. Sorry, Revenge fans out there. But tonight did not go well. And thus ends their MLG TKO run. Hippie, though. You have any last shout-outs? Any last things you want to talk about from these two games? Or anything to shout out?
I mean, the games in general were great, and I'd like to thank you once again for bringing me on. Guys, if you want to check me out on Twitter, it's very simple, @HippieCasting. You can always find me there, and just keep it up, guys. Stick to the match ticker, stick to Join Dota, keep up on every single match you can, and just live the Dota life. That's the best piece of advice I can give anyone.
Living the Dota life. All right, guys, that's going to be it for me as well, @DotaCapitalist. You want to follow me and hear my bullshit? That is where I spew it. And thanks so much for tuning in, guys. Really do appreciate it, especially when it's this late, like 4:30 in the morning. The more people I see in the chat talking about the games, having fun, the better experience it is for me. So thanks so much for tuning in, guys. Good night. We'll see you next time on the live stream.